Penguin Presents Fear the Dark by Chris Mooney. Read by Nick Landrum and Patricia Rodriguez.
I didn't mean to kill her, Sarah. It just happened. I know. She says in that quiet, soothing voice that made me fall in love with her all those years ago. She swallows and forces a smile.
I understand. You don't have to explain yourself.
We've done this dance before. Too many times, I'm ashamed to admit. And while I'm genuinely sorry each and every time, I also genuinely believe Sarah does, in fact, understand. This isn't wishful thinking on my part. We've been together a long time, Sarah and I. There are no secrets between us. Besides, Sarah couldn't keep something from me even if she wanted to. She's not a good actor, for one. But the reality is that she's not capable of deceit. Doesn't have it in her. She's too meek. Still wears her heart on her sleeve. One look at her face, and I know what she's feeling. Thinking. We're sitting together on the living room couch, the place, it seems, where we always end up having this conversation. I knock back the rest of my bourbon, my third, and stare into the fire, wondering again if there is such a place as hell. It just got away from me, again.
I know, she says quietly. Still, maybe you should have...
My glare stops her cold. The firewood snaps and hisses. Should have what? I prompt, aware of the heat climbing into my voice. Sarah knows better than to beat a dead horse. I've already apologized. The subject is closed. Done. She takes another delicate sip of her white wine and stares down into her glass, like there's an escape hatch hidden somewhere at the bottom. I see how I've hurt her, and I take our glasses and place them on the coffee table. Then I snuggle up next to her and take her hands in mine. Her smile is tight, not out of fear, but because even now, after all this time together, she's still embarrassed about her crooked teeth. You're beautiful, I say. She reddens and stares down at my hands. The skin is still pink and sore from the hot water and the vigorous scrubbing with the brush. It took a good 20 minutes to remove the blood, especially the blood caked underneath my fingernails. I was so angry, so consumed by rage, that I forgot to put on the gloves. I need to be more careful next time. And there will be a next time. We both know it. Sarah clears her throat.
A walk,
she says timidly. What?
We should take a walk. The fresh air will do us both some good.
Honey, it's the middle of the night, and it's freezing out.
I don't care.
The tentative smile on her face is as fragile as an eggshell. My heart sinks when I break it. I'm exhausted, I say gently. Maybe tomorrow night. She puts on a brave face.
Whatever you want.
Thanks for understanding. She nods, keeps nodding. I cup her face in my hands, fighting back tears. She swallows. Nervous. You mean the world to me. I love you. You know that, right?
I do,
she says. And I believe her. I kiss her forehead. Everything's going to be okay. I smile, kiss her gently on the lips. She crinkles her nose, like she's caught a whiff of a bad odor. What is it now? I ask sharply.
It's nothing.
No, go on. Say what's on your mind. I feel the anger, how it's already moved past the point of no return. I can't help it. Can't stop it. Say it.
Shower.
Her voice is barely above a whisper.
You should take a long, hot shower.
Because I stink? That what you're trying to tell me?
No, it'll relax you.
I'm too tired.
I know, baby,
she says, and my anger retreats like dirty water swirling down a drain. She knows I love it when she calls me baby.
It's just that you've got blood in your hair again.
Day 1. Chapter 1. Darby McCormick felt her muscles relax and her stomach unclench when the helicopter's landing skids touched down. She was so happy, so damn relieved, she wanted to kiss Ricky the pilot and his ridiculous Magnum PI. Ricky had fought major crosswinds since taking off from Denver. An hour later, when he began the descent to the helipad belonging to the Colorado State Troopers station in Castle Rock, there had been several tense minutes when she was sure the chopper was going to spin out of control and crash into the nearby trees. Darby thanked him and took off her headset. He didn't cut the engine. He had to fly back to Denver. She opened the side door to a blast of cold, grabbed her suitcase and rolling forensics kit, and stepped outside, ducking underneath the spinning blades. Hair blowing wildly across her face and shoulders, she made her way to a forest green Jeep Wrangler, the only civilian vehicle parked in the back of the station. Coop came out of the driver's door and made his way round to the front of the Jeep to greet her. His camel hair overcoat and navy blue suit jacket were unbuttoned, and as the copter took off and the rotor wash blasted against his clothes, she saw the Glock 23, one of the standard sidearms issued to federal agents, tucked inside his black leather shoulder holster. Coop had been working for the feds for a little over a year now, when his job at the private forensics company in London had been made redundant. Polite and fancy British speak for we've just laid your ass off, the Bureau had swooped in and hired him. No big surprise there. Coop was considered one of the best fingerprint experts in the country. What did take her by surprise was the thought that popped into her head. This was the first time she'd seen Coop in well over a year. He still looked the same, hard and fit. But his blonde hair was now cut shorter around the ears and neck to conform to federal regulations. As she drew closer, it amazed her how little he seemed to have aged since she'd met him nearly 15 years ago. Not only had Coop won the genetic lottery, he was often mistaken for the blonde-haired Tom Brady, the New England Patriots quarterback, but he had also been blessed with what she called the Dorian Gray gene. He was the kind of man who, like George Clooney, only got better looking with each passing year. Coop took her suitcase as the helicopter climbed into the air. Didn't think you were gonna make it, he yelled over the roar of its engine. Didn't think I was going to either. That storm hitting Ohio screwed up flights all over the country. I got out of Florida just in time. She pushed the aviator sunglasses back up her nose and brushed the hair away from her face as she followed him to the back of the Jeep. Why'd you book me a copter? Quicker than driving to Denver to pick you up. He opened the hatchback and placed her suitcase inside, then her forensics kit beside it. Coop shut the door. The bright afternoon sunlight highlighted the intensely deep color of his heterochromatic eyes. One was green, the other blue. You're looking a little green around the gills, he said. Bumpy ride? There were definitely a few moments when I was sure I was going to toss my airport breakfast burrito. Try not to hit any potholes along the way. He flashed his winning smile. It's great to see you. You too. It's been way too long. Coop embraced her. She kissed his grainy cheek and hugged him back, surprised at how fiercely she missed him. She pulled away before it went any further. How far to Red Hill? Darby asked after he'd climbed behind the wheel. About an hour. He slipped on a pair of Oakley sunglasses, put the car in gear, and started making his way out of the station's back lot. We arrived yesterday, around noontime. Been to Colorado before? Darby shook her head. First time. Air here's real thin, and it's even thinner in Red Hill. Town has the highest altitude in the state, 9,700 feet above sea level. It'll take a few days for our lungs to adjust, so we've been told.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.